Hope everyone can see me. I can see anyone. Okay, great. Sorry, technical issues. Hi, very welcome to this lovely author talk with the English Bookshop and Jen Campbell. I'm Fanny. I will be your host for the evening, and we're all so excited. Jen, who will be joining us in just a little second, is an author. This will be talking about her 10th book, actually. But she's previously written multiple genres, both for adults and for children. And she's also a booktuber, which is somebody who talks about books on YouTube, if you weren't caught up with that, where she talks a lot about fairy tales and the history of fairy tales, which is something that comes very much into play in this lovely collection. Yes, we'll just welcome Jen and she'll get to tell you more about it herself.
Hi,
Hi, Jen.
I was just spilling my tea. That was what I was doing while you were talking. Hey, I'm
It
glad you
was.
didn't catch that bit. It's fine.
It's fine. I actually flipped over a can right before as well. Butterfingers on both of
Yeah,
us.
definitely, definitely. Thank you for asking me to come here. Like, I mean, I know
Oh,
I'm in my flat, but you know what I mean.
yeah, we're so
It's
delighted to
lovely.
have you, and we're very excited to speak about your brand new book. It is the 10th, right? I did say that right. That
It
is
is the 10th.
amazing.
It's a bit scary, actually, I think. But yeah,
Yeah.
my first book came out nearly 10 years ago. So it's been about 1 year over the last 10 years, which is not
Amazing.
sustainable. I'm not going to keep doing that, probably. No.
So productive, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, why don't you tell us a little bit about this one?
About this one. Okay, so this one, I'm going to model it. I think it might be back to
Yes.
front. Is it back to front? No, it's not.
No,
No?
it looks
Is
right. Mine was wrong, but yours is correct. Huzzah!
Yay! So as you said, this is my 10th book, and this is a book that I've wanted to do for ages, and it kind of brings all of my favorite things together. So as you said, I write across different genres and different age groups. And in the past few years, not the last two, but before that, I was going into schools and talking to kids, mainly years 5 and 6, which are 10, 11-year-olds, about the history of fairy tales and teaching them poetry. And we would do fairy tale retellings in poetry. And I took such great delight in talking to kids about the history of fairy tales, because often I would say, okay, let's talk about fairy tales. And I can see something in their suit, but oh, princesses, boring. But I'm like, no. Let me talk to you about the blood and the gore and all of this. And their eyes just get so wide and they're fascinated by all the gruesomeness of it. And they came up with such wonderful ideas that one of the boys in the year 6 class, came up with a retelling of Rapunzel, where Rapunzel was a drag queen that wore all these different wigs. And if she didn't like the man that was climbing up the wig to her tower, she'd just take off her wig and let him drop to the ground. I was like, this is amazing. So I
Brilliant.
love talking to them about the history of fairy tales and telling them about fairy tales from around the world. And I thought, I'd kind of just like to write a book about this. So this is for primarily middle grade, so 8 to 13, but also for adults too, anyone who likes a creepy tale or two. So Sister Who Ate Her Brothers is a collection of 14 fairy tales from around the world that I have retold, and they are illustrated by Adam de Souza. So he has done some full, oh, this is a delightfully creepy one. He's done some full color plates. And then he's also done black and white borders on every single page. And it also comes with a ribbon bookmark, which is the most important thing about the book, I
It
think.
is.
And then at the end, I've done a little bit of a explanation about the history of fairy tales. And the whole collection is narrated by someone, me maybe, or someone else. I quite like to think it's me, a person sitting in the middle of a forest who wants to lure you into darkness and tell you scary tales. So it's a collection of old fairy tales, and I've told them in a traditional format so that they feel ancient, but I've also changed them as any fairy tale teller does, because that's what fairy tales are. They belong to the person who happens to be telling them in that particular moment, and all of the different additions that that person wants to add or subtract. So it's told in an old school fairy tale way, but with queer representation and representation of disfigurement as well. So I had a lot of fun writing it.
You can really tell the sort of joy you feel. You're like, oh yes, oh yes, now.
Exactly.
Now I'll turn the flippers on its head.
Yeah.
Yes, and I should also say you can actually win a copy. Yes. The audience can win a copy if you stay tuned a little bit later. So there's a good hook for you. Mm. I guess you have like a big collection of all these like sort of fairy tales from around the world. You don't have just the 14. So I was wondering kind of what is it that hooks you in to a story? What makes it like especially memorable for you?
That's a really hard question. Maybe I can talk about which ones I decided to include in here, because I think that pulls on that, but it's also slightly different. So if I wanted to include all of my favourite fairy tales, gruesome ones, I don't think it would actually make a very good book, in the sense that I'm probably, as you say, drawn to similar things in fairy tales that I love, and I don't want all the fairy tales that I include to be really similar. So I included some of my favourites and then did a deep dive researching others, and I wanted to make sure I had some longer ones and some shorter ones. I didn't want all of them to be really scary either. So some of them are chilling. And Adam's illustrations, it's really funny, actually. Adam's illustrations, I think, in some, make the tales even scarier. His illustration, I'm going to show one to you, in the Chinese fairy tale, which is the girl with the horse's head. This here absolutely terrified me when I saw it. I think it's more terrifying than the story itself. It's really creepy. It's about a horse who really wants to marry a girl. But then also I think in some of the actual textual scary fairy tales, his drawings help to kind of soften them a little bit. So I think it's a really interesting partnership. So yeah, not all of them are terrifying, but they're definitely at least creepy. Obviously I had to have lots to do with the sea, because that's something that I love. That mug is excellent, and cheers to you. And I also wanted to make sure that geographically we had lots of tales from different parts of the world. So we have tales from Korea, Ireland, Japan, Norway, Nigeria, an Inuit fairy tale, a tale from Egypt, Germany, Russia, El Salvador, South Africa, India, China, and Spain. So definitely all spread around. Yeah,
and I think it's so, you talk about this in your afterwards, how they in your intro about how they're similar because they were oral. So it's some things that sort of go through. And I do think the thing about girls marrying different animals seems to be like a global theme.
Definitely. And Penguin Classics a few years ago, do I have it to hand? My fairy tale bookcase is right here.
Yeah.
I don't buy it immediately. But anyway, Penguin Classics published a collection of specifically animal bride and bridegroom fairy tales from around the world.
Oh.
Which is really interesting. A few years ago. And they're thought to be focused on arranged marriage. And that was where that type of fairy tale came from, though not always. One of my favourites is in a collection called The Turnip Princess, which is by Frantavia von Schwanworth, I think that's right. And this was the barbarian fairy tales that were thought to be lost until a few years ago, and then they were translated into English and then they were published. And one of those fairy tales is about a woman who is very jealous of another woman who she sees having, I can't remember if it's twins or triplets, but she's very angry about it. And she says to her husband, you know, that's a lie, and that you can't have, you can have multiple babies, but it means that they're by different fathers, which is obviously not true, but that's what she says. And then she's so jealous that she ends up turning up into a wolf, and she doesn't know at that time that she's pregnant, and she gives birth to, I think it's 7 children, and they're all wolf cubs. And she's like, I can't tell my husband that I've given birth to 7, like, well, let alone wolf cubs, but anyway, children, because I told him that if a woman gives birth to multiple babies, it means she's been, you know, with other men. So instead, she instructs one of the people in the castle to go and leave the wolf cubs in the forest. But the king intercepts this messenger and says, what's going on? So the messenger explains and says, these are your children and your wife is trying to get rid of them. And so this is like prolonged payback, the patience. The husband decides to raise the 7 wolf cub children in secret until their 18th birthday, at which point he brings the 7 of them into his wife and be like, see, these are your sons and you've been keeping them from me for 18 years. I can't believe you lied. Like, why would you wait 18? It's just hilarious. I think it's really funny.
The communication skills are not...
No, I mean, they need to work on that. They need to work on that. But the wife, yes, is also part wolf. And that one's not based on arranged marriage. But a lot of them seem to be representations of that. And as you say, they appear in fairy tales all around the world. Yeah. Oh, can you hear that motorbike?
I can't. So hopefully not. that seems to be a thing. Like every YouTuber in England are always like, the sound seems to be so near them. I don't know. Maybe it's just the people.
I think maybe we're just very sensitive to it. And it's really hard to work out what gets picked up on a camera and what doesn't. It was weird. I filmed a video the other day and my neighbour was gardening and mowing her lawn. And I thought it was going to be really loud, but you couldn't hear it at all on the camera. No. It was just very distracting to me.
Maybe that is the thing when you're like a person used to working with audio. I don't know.
So.
We've gotten some questions, so I feel like we should jump into into them. Since we talked about the beautiful illustrations, Angelade asked, did you pick the illustrator yourself, and how was it to see your stories represented visually?
I didn't pick Adam myself. It's interesting. There are different relationships with authors and illustrators, and I've worked with 3 different illustrators with my books in the past. So I worked with someone called Greg McLeod on the first book that I wrote, which was Weird Things Customers Say in Bookshop. And that was quite different because he was doing very small sketches for some of the quotes. So it wasn't, I suppose, a partnership in the same way that my children's picture books were, where it was very much 50-50 and Katie was illustrating everything. So my first experience of working with an illustrator was Greg, and we met at the book launch, but we had never talked before that point. He's a really lovely guy. It was really lovely to chat with him. So that was a very removed experience, I felt, that time. Then when I did the Franklin and Luna picture book, the first one's called Franklin's Blind Bookshop, if anyone would like to check it out, I did pick Katie. So I had been talking to Thames and Hudson, who also published The Sister Who Ate Her Brothers, and had showed them my book, and they really liked it, and they said they would love to publish it, and they said they would go away and research illustrators, and I could go away and also research illustrators, and then we could share data. And I found Katie's work in the Bologna Book Fair catalogue, which is published every year, which is the big children's book fair that happens in Bologna every year. No. And they highlight up and coming, they highlight up and coming artists, and Katie was one of them, and I loved their illustrations. So I emailed her and said, could we like have a chat? So we met for coffee and we got on, and she did a sample illustration of Franklin Luna, and I loved it. And then we went on to work together on 3 different picture books. And again, like we met each other and we got on, but then we would work very separately. I didn't want to tell her what to draw because that's not my place as a writer. And I was always very excited to see what she would come up with. And then once she illustrated my words, we would decide if words needed to be removed from the text because you don't want to say things twice. So it was a really interesting experience working very closely with somebody once we'd both done our works and come together. And worked out how the text and the illustrations could really work in partnership together. With The Sister Who Ate Her Brothers, Adam was someone who was on Thames and Hudson's list of people that they really wanted to work with. And they said they had been waiting for the perfect project to come up that they would like to contact him about. And as you will have seen, like, he's really suited to this. Yeah, like, very dark graphic novel style. His work reminds me of Emily Carroll, if anyone is familiar with her work, which is also very dark fairy tales. So when I was talking to them about the next book I wanted to write, which was This Way Her Brothers, they said, look, we've got this person on our books who we think would be great. So he wasn't my pick, he was their pick. But I mean, if I had known about him, I would have picked him because I think that he's really great. So it was very exciting. I did all the text before I saw any illustrations by him at all, I think. Oh, no, that's a lie. Sorry. I actually did some sample illustrations for one story just so that we can make sure that we were, you know, happy with the way that things were progressing. So he did some sample drawings for the first story, which is the title story, The Sister Who Ate Her Brothers. And when I saw, which one was it? I think it was this one that I saw first, which I love. So it's the sister who's in the form of a fox and she's chasing after her brother. I thought, yeah, this is going to work really, really well. So it was really exciting to see him doing the drawings. He's Canadian, so we've actually never met, which is a shame, but it's been lovely seeing the work that he has produced, and I think he's done an amazing job. I love it.
Yeah, it's so interesting that you say you work kind of separately because they gel so well. Like, I would have imagined that it was more of a, like, a, you kept in touch, but maybe you were just, like, meant for each other in a authoring trade way.
He did come in with a couple of questions at some points because he was really very vigorous about the research that he was doing. So sometimes he would ask me specifically where fairy tales were from, so within regions, like within countries, so he could make sure that anything he was drawing was reflective of that place, which I thought was great. And yeah, I gave some feedback on his drawings towards the end, but really there wasn't much. There was nothing that I saw and thought, I don't like that. I love all of it.
That's so cool, though.
Yeah.
Let's see who else wanted to know. Ali wants to know what initially got you interested in fairy tales. Were you interested as a child or did it come later on for you? When did you realize they used to be gory? I want to know.
Well, again, I'm seeing if there is a book here that I can. Yes. Okay. Let me tell you. I have a story.
Bring it on. Jen? Oh, there you go. Okay, you blitzed a little bit, but you're back. No panic.
I'm back. My computer had a moment. I think it's because I disappeared from the screen. It was like, are we finished? Okay, all right.
We'll rest. So we'll take a break.
When I was a kid, like most people our age, I think, you know, I would associate fairy tales with Disney. The first one that I probably saw in the cinema was The Little Mermaid. I think that came out in 1989. And I was born in 1987. So I think that was the first one that I saw. And, you know, I liked Disney. The songs, still sing them very badly in the shower. But the first time I encountered dark fairy tales was through Roald Dahl, who did a book called Revolting Rhymes. And I'm going to read you a little bit of the last one, which is a retelling of The Three Little Pigs. But there's intertextuality going on because he involves Little Red Riding Hood. And it was the first time I realized, oh, you can play with these stories. You can change the ending. You can make the characters do. It's basically like fan fiction. Fairy tale is like fan fiction. And I used to really love fan fiction when I was a teenager. So I think maybe that's why they're fun to play around with, because you've got a core. You've got some plot, which is hard. Plot is the hardest part of writing. So I think that's also why I like fairy tales. And then you can experiment. So this is the end of Roald Dahl's retelling of Three Little Pigs, which is in rhyme. And I'm sure that we all know Three Little Pigs, but just in case if you don't, there are three little pigs and a wolf who wants to eat them. So he goes to each of their houses in turn, and one of them has his house built of, what is it, sticks? And then of wood, and then of bricks. Is that correct? Have I got that right? I think that's right. Okay, so...
I don't know. I don't recall.
Straw, then twigs, and then bricks. That's it.
Right.
I should remember. So this is the wolf, and he has got to the second house, which is the house built of twigs. and 6. The wolf said, okay, here we go. He then began to blow and blow. The little pig began to squeal. He cried, oh, wolf, you've had one meal. Why can't we talk and make a deal? The wolf replied, not on your Nelly. And soon the pig was in his belly. Two juicy little pigs, wolf cried. But still, I am not satisfied. I know full well my tummy's bulging, but oh, how I adore indulging. So, creeping quietly as a mouse, the wolf approached another house, a house which also had inside a little piggy trying to hide. But this one, piggy number 3, was bright and brainy as could be. No straw for him, no twigs or sticks. This pig had built his house of bricks. You'll not get me, the piggy cried. I'll blow you down, the wolf replied. You'll need, pig said, a lot of puff, and I don't think you've got enough. Wolf huffed and puffed. And blew and blew. The house stayed up as good as new. If I can't blow it down, Wolf said, I'll have to blow it up instead. I'll come back in the dead of night and blow you up with dynamite. Pig cried, you brute, I might have known. Then, picking up the telephone, he dialed as quickly as he could the number of Red Riding Hood. Hello, she said, who's speaking to? Oh, hello, Piggy, how are you? Pig cried, I need your help, Miss Hood. Oh, help me, please, do you think you could? I'll try, of course, Miss Hood replied. What's on your mind? A wolf, Pig cried. I know you've dealt with wolves before, and now I've got one at my door. My darling pig, she said, my sweet, that's simply right up my street. I've just begun to wash my hair, but when it's dry, I'll be right there. So a short while later, through the woods, came striding brave Miss Riding Hood. The wolf stood there, his eyes ablaze and yellowish like mayonnaise. His teeth were sharp, his gums were raw, and spit was dripping from his jaw. Once more, the maiden's eyelid flickers. She drew a pistol from her knickers. Once more, she hit the vital spot and killed him with a single shot. Pig peeping through the window stood and yelled, oh, well done, Miss Riding Hood! But Piglet, you must never trust young ladies from the upper crust. For now, Miss Riding Hood, one note, not only has 2 wolfskin coats, but when she goes from place to place, she has a pigskin travelling case. Miss Riding Hood is not very nice. She's not the heroine. No. So when I read that as a kid, I was like, this is so much fun. Yeah, her eyelid glitters the flicker. She whips the pistol from her knickers. I mean, yeah. That all of the time, please. So I read that as a kid and then did the obligatory Angela Carter reading as a teenager, and Jeanette Winston, and kind of thought about how fairy tales can be used as this psychological device to kind of talk about trauma, which is what those writers sometimes do, because fairy tales mean that you can talk about something in a very removed way set in a, it's just a form of storytelling that everyone kind of understands. And I think they can be a lot deeper than a lot of people might assume they would be given their simple storytelling format. And as we said before, there are lots of repeating elements in fairy tales. The numbers 3, 6, and 7 are really important. Things happen a couple of times, like Hansel and Gretel are left in the woods, I think, 3 times. And it's on the 3rd time that they end up finding the gingerbread house. And those repeating elements were there to help people remember them because, as you said, they were spoken and they weren't written down. And this was actually one of the conversations I had with my editor when I started writing this book, because I was writing it in 2020. And the theme of the book is scare people. That's the theme. And I said to my editor, I said, should I be writing this right now? Like, the world is quite scary. Should I be scaring the children? Is this necessary? Should I stop? And I was thinking, oh, I don't know. But then I was reflecting on it, and I went back to an interview that was in the Fairy Tale Review, which is a wonderful literary journal that has fairy tale retellings in it. And Kate Bernheimer, and I think it was Jack Zeitz, and it was someone else, Kiki Smith, who's a folklore artist. They were talking about fairy tales and horror. And Kiki said that fairy tales are a tool to discuss fear, but in a helpful way. If you can have a scary story and say, once upon a time, everyone understands it's not real. You're putting it in a wood. you're making something that scares you innately and turning it into something that you can speak. And it's a good tool for children to talk about what scares them and to overcome fear. So actually, I hope, and I'm not saying this is a marketing tool, but scary fairy tales are helpful now more than ever for kids to kind of talk about what is scary and what's scary in the world and how can we make that better. So I'm using that as a tool when talking to kids about fairy tales now, which has been really interesting.
Yeah. And that was, I mean, I think children likes to be scared too, not to be forgotten.
Oh, no, I think they do. And I think as adults, we then overthink everything and we forget how simply we can take things as children, like the delight in being scared without overcomplicating it. Yeah, no, kids love the gore a lot. I read this book to my niece and nephew over FaceTime because we didn't have, I like to read them my children's stories anyway, just to make sure that it's gelling with the kids, you know, because I am not a child anymore. My niece wanted to listen in, even though she's five, because my nephew's eight, and obviously she wouldn't allow him to be part of something that she was not also allowed to be part of. Even though she was five, she was she declared that the book was gross, but in a delighted way, and my nephew said it was disgusting in a delighted way. So I really wanted to put those quotes on the book. You know, Jen's nephew says disgusting, Jen's niece says gross. We didn't go for that in the end, but I did think it would be a good thing to do.
It is. I think so. And now Paula asks, do you have a favorite characters that you like to write about? I think this is like all over your books. I mean, do they have any particular characteristics, either in their personality or appearance?
I mean, I have to be careful because I think all writers have their quirks that they go back to. So I kind of have a list of things that I have to ration myself on now because I do it maybe not too much, but just they're easy reaches for me. And they're not necessarily characteristics of people, but for instance, things in jars. I include too many things in jars. I mean, there are some things in jars in this book, in the fairy tale, the souls trapped under the ocean. The merman keeps souls in jars, in lobster nets, which is kind of like jars. But, you know, that was in the original. So what are you going to do? I mean, I'm just going to, that was already there. That wasn't me. So, yeah, I have to ration talking about ghosts in jars, lights in jars, things like that. It's a very specific thing that I go back to again and again. As for people, I think I especially enjoy writing about queer relationships and obviously like good rep of disfigurement and disability. And they're things that I'm drawn back to again and again. But I think within that spectrum, that's obviously a huge like spectrum of characters. But that's definitely my favourite thing to write about. I don't think I have a specific trait for a person I go back to again and again. And as for specific people that I've enjoyed writing, I don't know. I think this is a cliche and I'm sorry, but I kind of always enjoy the project that I'm in. And then afterwards, it's always my most recent thing that I've written that I feel the closest to emotionally. But I think because I've written a lot of short things, there haven't been like huge characters for me apart from Franklin and Luna, I suppose, who I've gone back to many times. I mean, Neil Armstrong, Luna's tortoise, is always just really fun to write because he's ridiculous. Tortoise called Neil Armstrong, who is based on Mr. M's tortoise, who's called Penny Sloan. There is actually a tortoise that I know, and that was why I wanted to include a tortoise in the picture book as well. But I can't bring Penny Snow to book events because she would just bite the children, and that's not a good thing. We don't want that.
Caroline wants to know, when rewriting a classic fairy tales, what themes are most important to highlight more or include to relate to today's society?
I guess that goes back to what I was just saying in that highlighting like queer themes and disfigurement. I've really tried hard to research queer fairy tales of old, and there are a few out there, and I'm sure that there are loads. Like when they were told orally, obviously there will have been a lot and shared within queer communities, but when it came to them being written down and popularized, they were often written down by men who then didn't include those things. And it is why, one of the reasons why representation of women in fairy tales is not that great, because it was the men historically, hundreds of years ago, who were writing them down. But there are queer metaphors to be found in fairy tales. Hans Christian Andersen is thought to have written The Little Mermaid because he was in love with his friend Edward Collins. So it's supposed to be an extended metaphor about not being able to obviously be with the person you love, but to be with that person, you would fundamentally have to change who you were. Well, if you wanted to pass the strait, for instance, you would have to essentially stop being a mermaid and completely transform in a painful way to then exist as a non-queer person, and it's just not a viable thing for him to have done. So it's a really sad story when we think about it in that way. Sad story anyway, but especially with regards to that. So when I was retelling them, I wanted to make sure that there were queer stories in here. As a queer disabled person, that's something that I'm very passionate about. So the Irish tale in here is a queer story. That was a queer story historically. Not overtly so, but the word love is mentioned. Like the man does love the merman. And mermaids and mermen are really important symbolically in like queer folklore, and I mean that in a cultural sense, like that transformation of body. So I wanted to include that. It does, spoiler, not have a happy ending, which historically it didn't. And I'm very aware of the trope of the gay person dies at the end, like, which is a really annoying trope. But because it's a queer fairy tale that does actually exist, I was like, I want to include it, even though it has that. And to be fair, these fairy tales, most of them don't have happy endings anyway. This is not a collection about like happy love stories. But there are two happy love stories in this. And one of them is a straight relationship and one of them is a queer relationship. So the end story is the princess and the woman in the glass mountain, which is about the princess who falls in love with a woman. And I really love writing that story. That is about a bald princess as well. So I wanted to change the way that, well, people would visually describe, that didn't make sense. I wanted to change the way that people were described in fairy tales, like their bodily features, because often in fairy tales, because they're old forms of storytelling, it would use shorthand methods of trying to tell the audience, okay, this person's the bad guy and this person is the good guy. I'm going to use all the air quotes here. So the princess would be so beautiful and the witch would be like, ugly. And then there would be disability and disfigurement used as punishment if someone did a bad thing. So in Beauty and the Beast, which was a fairy tale originally written as a novel in the 1700s, that, as we talked about, is one of the animal bridegroom stories and is thought to be inspired by arranged marriage, but in particular one arranged marriage, which was one of the people in that arranged marriage was someone called Petrus Gonzalez, who was born in the 1500s in Tenerife, and he had a condition called hypertrichosis, which is where you're born with hair all over your body. So his parents sold him to the courts of France, and he was displayed as an oddity in the courts, and he was passed from royal court to royal court. And then eventually one of the monarchs decided that they thought it would be funny to marry him off to someone they didn't like called Lady Catherine. So they arranged a secret marriage and they weren't allowed to see each other beforehand. And then they met and they were married. And the joke was on them because they ended up falling in love and they had seven children together. But that was a very famous story because it happened in the court. So it's thought, though we can never prove it, that Beauty and the Beast was based on that. But obviously in the fairy tale of Beauty and the Beast, in the original novel, the man, I'm going to call him Adam because that's what he was called in the Disney version, Adam was turned into the beast in the novel because he refused to marry a fairy, and the fairy was really cross. So she turned him into a beast and said that, you know, no one will love you, but if someone does love you, then you can turn back into a beautiful man. So it's when he, in her eyes, learns to be good that he's able to change his form. But obviously that's not how life works, and if you have a disfigurement or a disability, you're not rewarded and made non-disabled by being a good person. So that was definitely messaging I wanted to remove from these fairy tales. So the word beautiful is not used at all apart from once, and that's about a man, and then I wanted to make sure that the female characters have a lot of agency in these fairy tales. whilst also reflecting the world that we live in. So no pun intended, I didn't want to turn it into a fairy tale in that I wanted to forget about misogyny existing, for instance. So that is still in there. It's just people are not rewarded for their bad behavior. And also people's appearance is not based on the things that they do or the things that they say. So we have got a deaf man in here, we're celebrating bald princess, and we also have an Inuit fairy tale in here, which is about a princess called Sedna, who doesn't want to marry anyone that her father wants her to marry. So she instead decides to marry her dog, or she says, I'm going to marry him because that's the only person I want to marry. So her dad gets really cross, drags her out into the ocean and throws her into the sea. But she tries to hang on to the boat, so he gets an axe and cuts off her fingers. And then she grows up to be the goddess of the deep. And that's one that I'm particularly fond of, as someone with ectodactyly, so missing fingers. So I wanted to include that one for younger me, I think, because I would love to have read that when I was younger.
I actually did read that one when I was younger. I realized when I was reading this one, I recognized that one. And it really...
It's interesting, isn't it? Because some of these fairy tales for me were newer, but it depends what country you happen to be in, because some of them are going to be more familiar. So I think that's really always, it's interesting to talk about that with people. So it's interesting that you knew that one.
Yeah, I think we had one of those fairy tales from around the world books, I think. But it's kind of interesting. Right, somebody asked, I mean, you did mention this with like the good and the evil sort of thing. Somebody is asking, and I think that's kind of relevant to what Disney is doing now, too. But do you think villains in fairy tales deserve to have a backstory as some sort of justification, or should some villains just remain villains?
What do I think that we can...
Should villains...
I'm reading it, because the question's on the screen. Do I think all villains in fairy tales deserve to have a backstory? Oh, I see. Okay. I don't think... Oh, that's interesting, isn't it? You're right. Everyone has been doing this.
Very much so.
I mean, I think it's interesting, like, to humanise people, because, as we said, like, fairy tale retellings, these are different... Because they are retellings, but I'm not doing that backstory, like, deep dive that this indicates. But some fairy tale retellings do take an aspect of fairy tale or one character and then expand it. And then I think that kind of takes it out of the fairy tale realm, because you're making someone really three-dimensional. Often characters in fairy tales are not three-dimensional. It's like, this person is good, this person is bad. There's not much in between. That's just the way they functioned, because they have to be simple tales that were told quickly to people. You didn't have that space to kind of make it like a complete patchwork. So I think when like villains and fairy tales are expanded upon and made more human, I don't think that's a bad thing to do. I just think it's a different thing to do. And I think it then becomes a different story entirely. What I don't like is when a villain, maybe in a fairy tale or maybe just in an older story that's canon, something that is told a lot and is part of that cultural like conscious, like, I don't know, like Peter Pan or Alice in Wonderland, or more recently comic universes where there are so many backstories and they've existed for decades. And now obviously so many Marvel films, DC films are being made. I don't like when older problematic characters are brought back, and to justify their disfigurement, if they're a villain, they're then given a backstory that then shows why they became evil, and often it's tied up with them becoming disabled and then them becoming bitter and hating the world. And I don't think that, I'm often asked, does that mean their disfigurement or disability is justified because you've given it a story? And I don't think that that is right. I don't think that's right. On an individual basis, I think you can always excuse that type of story. But when it's done across so many different storylines and so many different universes, like Marvel, DC, fairy tales, we can notice that this is actually more of a worldwide problem that we have when discussing disability and disfigurement. So I think villains like that shouldn't be given backstories to justify their disability. But if that's not what we're talking about, and we're just talking about villains and trying to work out on the whole why they are the way they are, which is not tied up with disfigurement and disability. I do find that interesting. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Johanna asks, how was it to fully focus on gory fairy tales in a book rather than sprinkle it in into your other novels and short stories? Full gore really, focus.
Really fun. Really, really fun. I really, I enjoyed it because I felt like I had the freedom to do that without integrating it into something else. Because it's unapologetically just gory fairy tales. So I had a lot of fun. One of the frustrating bits of researching was that I was hoping to find more positive representation of disfigurement and disability to organically incorporate in. And then the more research I did, the more I realized I'm just going to have to create that myself because historically it's not really there. But apart from that, yeah, I had a lot of fun doing this research, and I would like to do more of these books in the future. We're discussing that at the moment with a slightly different focus, but still the historical fairy tale element, which is something that I'm really fascinated by and with. And if anyone isn't familiar with my YouTube channel, I have a series over there called Fairy Tales with Jen, where I will take a particular fairy tale and dissect it and look at the history of that particular story. So I'm hoping to do more of that in the future, in video form, but also in book form as well. There's just so much material to research. It's endless, which is quite fun.
Yeah. I don't think I told you that, but I've been watching that series for like so long. So I was very aware of you before this this talk come up, and I enjoy it so much. It really, I really do recommend if somebody's here and they haven't seen Jen's channel, like really check it out. It's, you learn so much.
But there is just so much material. Before I give talks on it, I have to go back and rewatch my old videos to remind myself of the things that I've learned. I'm like, oh, I used to know that. Let me write that down.
Yes.
A huge, huge history. Huge.
Yeah, there is. And like how it changes over time. That's very fascinating.
Yeah, so if anyone who isn't aware, I mean, this is probably, it's common sense when you think about it, but I think I had never really thought about it in depth until, I don't know, like 6 or 7 years ago when I really got interested in the history of fairy tales. But folklorists have created something called the Arne Thompson Usa Index, which folklorists argue over, but I like it as a fun tool. So it's like a database of fairy tales, and they can cross-reference and catalogue them based on different themes and things that happen within a story. So there'll be a list of stories that have poisoned apples in them, or a list of stories where people get lost in the woods. And then you can kind of trace elements of stories and work out maybe how one fairy tale informed another one, and maybe how they travel between countries and across continents. And again, it's not something that we can definitively prove. We can't say, oh, this fairy tale from 400 years ago definitely inspired this one from 200 years ago, because why would you ever be able to prove that? But it's fun to speculate. Speculating is really, really fun. And what we can do is disprove things. If we can't prove something, we can disprove that fairy tales are linked. So we thought for a while maybe really old versions of Cinderella were linked. There's one called Rhodopis, which is, it was written down in Greece, but it's based on a tale that happens in Egypt and was thought to be historically accurate. I don't know how true that is, but Rhodopis was thought to have existed, and that she was sold into slavery in Egypt. And the tale goes that she was washing her clothes by the River Nile, and a falcon came down and stole one of her golden slippers. And then he flew away with it, dropped it. A pharaoh found it and thought, I really love this slipper. I'd love to marry the person who owns it. Casual. So then he did a countrywide search to find Rhodopis, and then he's like, I love you so much, let's get married. So that's one version, but then there's also one from China, which is called Ye Shen, and it's about a young girl who lives in a cave with her stepmom and half-sister, and she wants to go to the local market, this festival, but she's not allowed because she has a horrible stepmother who won't allow her to do fun things. But she makes friends with a magical fish who grants her wishes, and so she wishes for a gown to go to this festival. So she goes to the festival but leaves a feather behind from the gown, which is found by a think it's a prince, or at least someone who is very well respected, who then thinks, I would love to marry the person who left this feather behind. So then he goes on this quest to try and find her, they want to get married, and then her stepmother and half-sister are killed in a rock slide because they've been so hideous. Just punishment. But these fairy tales can't be related because the trade links between Egypt and China weren't open at that time. So they hadn't connected. They didn't know each other. So there's no way that these old forms of Cinderella could be connected. So clearly there's something going on about the particular types of stories we like to tell and may invent, which is fun to think about. I love it.
Yeah. Really. Yes, and so this is, I'm going to tell everyone that this is the very last chance to put the keyword fairy tale into the live chat if you want to win the book, because we're just about to draw the winner. So
you get, like, exciting.
A minute. Yeah. And if somebody else wants to buy a copy of the book with a signed copy, you can do that. You can contact us at
I will sign.
Yes, she will sign.
I will. Here's the pen. I'm ready. I'm ready to sign.
She's ready to go. Are you ready to receive? So you can just email stockholm@bookshop.se. But I think the end card has our contact information. So you can just wait out with that. So... yeah.
How do we do this? Do you have a random number generator? How do we select somebody?
Yes. Well, Jonas, who is the technical person here, he has found some sort of those spinny wheel things. So he's about to do it, I think. So yeah, the text disappeared. Now it's happening.
Ooh!
Graphics! Let's see.
Ooh. Hey,
Molly!
Congrats, Molly!
Hooray!
Yay!
Huzzah! So you will, since we're streaming on a couple of different platforms, Molly, you need to email us at stockholm@bookshop.se. Again, I'm pretty sure it'll be on the end card, but we just... since it's different on Facebook.
You got overexcited by the giveaway. I think that was it.
Yeah, I think so. So please get in touch with us, Molly, and you'll get your book. There we are. So, is there anything else you think we should know about your book?
I could do a little reading for you.
Yes, please.
A little bit of a taste of,
yes,
of the book.
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay. Kind of work out which one to read, because I often read the introduction, which I think is a good indicator of the book, but
yeah,
maybe people have heard that before.
And like the afterword I really enjoyed too, so sometimes you can just skip them. Don't skip them in this book.
No, the afterword this time is important. Skipping the afterword as well, but no, this one definitely should be here. Just flicking through. Tell you what, let me read you the fairy tale from Germany.
Yes.
This one, which is called The Adults Who Lost Their Organs.
It's dark. Oh,
would you mind holding up the illustrations for people to see? That would be great. Thank you so much. Yes. Okay. The Adults Who Lost Their Organs. There were once three, but this is a fun fact of me. A fun fact of mine, that historically surgeons used to be butchers. Like doctors and surgeons were very, very different. And often if there was a war on, butchers would be asked to go to battlefields in order to cut people's limbs off if they were injured. Great. I'm not going to get my butcher to do my surgery. I don't think I would enjoy that.
Okay. Oh, this was hard.
There were once three butchers who were called away to war. it was their job to operate on soldiers, to sew wounds and bandage limbs. They called themselves the butcher surgeons. The first was the height of 2 broomsticks. The second was the daughter of a witch. The third had a beard shaped like a tree. One night, after a particularly violent battle, the butcher surgeons were looking for somewhere to sleep. They swaggered into a small village and knocked on the door of an inn. "We want a room," they grinned, "but we don't have any money." The innkeeper laughed nastily. "Then you can sleep on the streets. You can't stay here." "Ah, but what about a different kind of payment?" They leaned over the threshold. "What about a magic trick?" "Magic," the innkeeper snorted. "There's no such thing." The butcher surgeons looked at him with pity. "Here's what we propose," said the first. "We will each cut off a body part." "You will keep those body parts safe overnight," said the second. "And then in the morning, we will reattach those body parts," said the third. "And if we are unable to do so," they chorused, "we will come back next week and pay you double." The innkeeper paused. Surely this was easy money. No one could cut off parts of their body and reattach them again. "Okay," he said, holding out a silver plate. "Give them to me." The first butcher surgeon cut off a hand and handed it over. The second pulled out an eye and rolled it onto the plate. The third reached inside his chest and pulled out his heart. It twitched red and purple in the fading evening light. The innkeeper didn't know what to say. He held the plate at arm's length, invited them inside, and ushered them into the biggest room. After all, when their magic trick failed and they had to pay double, he wanted to make sure they paid for the most expensive room. Then he raced into the kitchen, balancing the hand and the eyeball and the heart. He thrust them at the cook, shouting, "Keep these safe, do you hear?" The cook did hear, but he didn't care. He put the body parts to one side and promptly forgot all about them. Soon enough, the kitchen cat jumped onto the counter. She tiptoed around the plate and gave the human flesh a sniff. The cat thought it smelled delicious, so she opened her mouth wide. She swallowed the eye, then she gobbled the hand. And finally, she chewed the heart delicately until all of it was gone. When the cook realized what had happened, he panicked. He didn't want to lose his job, so he raced into the streets with his sharpest knife. He cornered a thief and cut off his hand. He chased the kitchen cat and took out one of her eyes. He grabbed the pig from the local farm and pulled out its heart. He placed these glistening body parts on the silver plate, then put them in the fridge, out of harm's reach. In the morning, the well-rested butcher surgeons came down for breakfast and the innkeeper presented them with the silver plate. "Let's see this magic then," he sneered. Sure, it was still alive. The butcher surgeon smiled. The first sewed the hand back on with a fine golden thread. The second tossed the eyeball into the air and caught it in her socket. The third hugged the heart gratefully and rammed it back inside his chest. "Thanks for your hospitality," they said, bowing. "Now, we'll be on our way." But it was a curious thing. The butcher surgeons didn't feel quite like themselves that day. The first felt their hand twitching, longing to steal coins. The second, when night fell, could now see in the dark. The third had the strongest desire to roll around in mud. "Shall we have mice for dinner?" asked the second butcher surgeon. "I could catch some for us." "I could steal us some money and buy us something better," said the first. "Why go hunting or stealing when we could just eat scraps?" said the third, who was hunting for vegetable peelings in a nearby bin. "Oh dear," said the first. "Meow," said the second. "Oink," said the third. Realizing they had been tricked, they hurried back to the inn. They hammered on the door, calling out for their body parts, but there was nothing that could be done. All that was waiting for them was a very full cat, an apologetic cook, and an innkeeper who now definitely believed in magic. There we go. A bedtime Yay. Story for you all.
Yay.
Okay. That story was actually catalogued by the Grimms, among other people, but because the Grimms were very, very suspicious of surgeons, so they wanted to collect a fairy tale that showed that maybe they couldn't be trusted. But I like to think they can be trusted. And clearly it's the cook and the innkeeper who can't be trusted. They're the ones that are no good. I mean, surgery is like magic. I kind of get the suspicion.
Yes, it depends on where you stand on magic, really.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, science and magic, very close.
Okay, yeah. I think we're going to wrap up with that little story. I'm just going to remind everyone there's a little thing downstairs again. But the 2nd December, we have another event with Hanna Österrik. And yeah, thank you so much for being here, for talking to me, for reading.
Thank you for asking me. It's been really lovely. And also, this is my first Bookshop event as well, which is very exciting because, you know, times we live in, and the book has been out in the world now for 6-7 weeks. So it's very lovely to actually do an event talking about it. Obviously, I talk about it online all the time. No one can stop me talking about it, but it's nice to like do an official something for it, which is really great. So thank you for having me.
Yeah, oh, thank you. This was actually my first author talk as well, so it was...
Yeah, well,
yay! Everyone survived!
Yay!
Do you want to let people know where they can find you? Or
anything? Oh, you can find me on the internet. I'm just on the internet. If you Google my name, it'll come up in a variety of places. Yeah, I have a YouTube channel where I review books, which is youtube.com/JenBCampbell. You can find me at JenBCampbell. That's the letter B for Victoria on Twitter, Instagram as well. And yeah, that's it. And I also do writing workshops. If anyone is wanting to hone their writing craft, you can find out about that on my website too. Thanks for having
me. Great. Okay. Yeah. Thanks everyone for watching. Have a lovely evening, everyone.
Thanks everyone. Bye.
Bye.